Hey everybody, Dr. Mike here. Today is Mother's Day here in the United States. I decided to take some time to honor my mom, who unfortunately I lost during medical school. And I'd love to share my story of how she raised me, how she made me into the person I am today. I was born in Saransk, Russia in late 1989, which makes me 27 years old. I grew up in a tiny town. It's right outside of Moscow. Everybody knows each other. My father was a physician in Russia, so he was practicing medicine for the local police department out there. My mom was a math professor at an incredibly high institution in Russia. Incredibly smart woman. She knew how to not only understand mathematics, but how to teach and explain it to someone as silly as myself. When we came to the United States, it was December of 1995. One of my fondest memories was getting on that airplane for the first time, because I've never been on an airplane. One of the flight attendants gave me a Delta pin. And in Russia, when I was growing up, in a communist era Russia, you didn't have little gadgets and tinker toys to play with. So the fact that I got these like little wings was so amazing. And I was like, wow, they're just giving these out for free. They don't even want any money for them. The flight attendants would ask what we wanted to drink. And none of us spoke English except my sister, who had some basic English tutoring, and she knew how to ask for a Coke and a Pepsi for my dad and my mom. And I thought, wow, it's so cool, she speaks another language, I'm gonna learn English and I'm gonna be great at it. When we first came to the United States, my dad's role was to establish himself as a doctor all over again. So he needed to go to medical school and do that whole process all over again, which means that he wasn't around a lot of the time. So essentially, my mom became my primary caretaker. She spent time with me going to school, she brought me to my first grade class, and I remember on the first day of school, I would be nonstop crying. She obviously didn't have any degrees that were useful here. She didn't know the language, so the only job she can get was sweeping floors for a couple of dollars an hour. She would walk 2 miles every day to this job and not pay the $1.25 or whatever it was at the time for bus fare. To watch her do that and never complain sort of gave me that confidence that I shouldn't complain, and that yes, there's gonna be some difficult days and you just have to do it. There's a Russian saying called "Через не могу," which means going through, I can't. It doesn't translate well in English, but it's almost saying that even when you can't, you should do it. Her and my dad would constantly repeat that phrase to me, even when I was tired and didn't want to do homework, when I had a sporting activity that I needed to do and I didn't want to do it, they would always just say, this is how you have to do it. Another thing that really motivated me about my mom is how she perpetually shifted gears into a way that would better benefit our family. She picked up computer programming, learned C++ and all these computer languages completely on her own. Just went to the public library, picked up books, didn't have computers back in Russia, barely knew English. A few years later, she was doing so well that Chase hired her, up until the computer slash tech bubble, whatever you want to call it, and she needed to pivot again. She started taking the necessary courses to become a math professor all over again here in the United States. She was able to get her master's and become a fully licensed professor. My mom, so incredibly beautiful. Tall, elegant, very great features. What was amazing about her was that even though she was this beautiful woman, even into her late 40s, early 50s, she was so stunningly beautiful, she was still incredibly sweet. She was nice to everyone around her. She never carried herself with her nose held high that she's accomplished so much. When People Magazine says you're the sexiest doctor alive, you want to take that with a grain of salt and say, okay, like, they're naming me that, but that means nothing unless I do something great for the world. And I really take that message directly from her. In late 2009, unfortunately, my dad lost his mom, which was my grandmother. She had a lot of illnesses prior to that. Her health wasn't in great condition. Her husband, my grandfather, my dad's dad, ultimately lost his life as well. He had a hip fracture with complications, which ultimately led to his demise. And it was such a tough moment for my dad, losing both parents. Then you fast forward 3-4 months later, my mom was diagnosed with CLL, which is a form of leukemia. What's unique about CLL is it's an illness generally reserved for the older population, 65 and up. It's usually not the thing that claims your life. You can live with it 10, 20 years. But my mom had a more advanced case, a unique case, that was more aggressive and was really hurting her immune system and her ability to fight off infections. So she was becoming sick more and more often. Her white blood cells were rising in number, which means that they started clumping and forming clots. And she generally was just becoming more and more sick and frail. We were gonna have to have her brother fly in from Russia to give a bone marrow transplant to her. Basically, we had to give her chemo, give her radiation in order to destroy her immune system and allow his immune system and his cells, his bone marrow, to take in her body. It's a very tough process because obviously when you destroy someone's immune system, they're very prone to being sick. And at that moment, we had to be very careful around her, always washing our hands. She was always wearing a mask. Going through chemo, she lost her hair, which was very tough for her. And I was just learning about all these illnesses and all these diseases, but watching one firsthand was so scary to me because now it was affecting me on a primary level. In December 2010, it was a regular night. My dad asked me to pick my mom up from Memorial Sloan Kettering, which is one of the great cancer hospitals here in New York. And he said, if you can pick her up, I'm kind of tired. And I was studying for my tests, but whenever my dad asked, I was always there for him. So I went to go pick up my mom. And when I went there, she wasn't outside as she usually was. So I kind of left the car, parked illegally in the front, ran into the hospital and saw she was seated and there was doctors surrounding her. And they said that she fell. And they wanted to keep her, but she was firmly against it. She said she wanted to go home and she kept repeating that over and over again. My gut, being a first year medical student, was to listen to the doctors. So I immediately dialed my dad. He spoke to her. He assumed that she was just tired from her cancer treatments and that she just needed to go home and rest. So I agreed, I helped her into my car. And actually upon leaving that day, the doctor shook my hand. He said, look, she may look sick now, but we've officially cured her cancer. She doesn't have cancer anymore. She's completely cancer free, which was such a great thing in my eyes because, you know, we've been battling this for months. To hear that was such a promise. I get a call late that night from my sister saying that mom is sick. She went back to the hospital, which was pretty routine at that point because she was getting sick a lot. So I said, as soon as I finish my test, I'll be there. I took my test early that morning, went to the hospital, and saw that my mom was intubated. She was in the intensive care unit, and right away, I knew from my limited medical training that this was the day, and probably nothing good was gonna happen. One of the doctors sort of took me aside and explained to me that she's on 3 pressor medications, which is a medication to artificially increase your blood pressure, meaning if they took one of those off, she would die. I instantly knew the gravity of the situation. My sister and my dad were sort of mad at me in the moment that I didn't have hope, but I think of myself as a realist and I saw where that situation was heading. We spent more time with her that day up until the inevitable happened. Her heart stopped. They called a code blue, which means that there's someone without a pulse. Medical students, residents like I am now, run into the room, start doing chest compressions, alarms going off everywhere. My dad's crying, my sister's crying there. And they're doing chest compressions and it's obviously futile. So the doctors starts having that conversation with my dad that maybe we should stop doing the chest compressions because this isn't helping her. It's only causing her more harm than good. And my dad, again, being the firm optimistic self, he said, no, keep doing it, keep doing it. I saw he was being irrational. He wasn't helping my mom at that point. So I had to sort of step in and be the one that told the medical students, you stop. Let's call the time of death, which was a very difficult thing for me to do. It actually gives me a lot of empathy that I use every day with my patients now when I'm in those situations, because I know how those family members feel. And the first thing that I did when we called it, I hugged my dad because I knew he was gonna break down. This guy gave up his life to come to America for his kids, go through a whole new education system, go through medical school a second time, set up his life. Now that he finally found some financial success, he was hoping that him and his wife could enjoy that, and now all that came crashing to a halt. So I knew I had to hug him and give him that support. My dad is usually the leader, and he's always the one telling me that, again, that Russian saying, "Cheres не могу," which means you have to do it through I can't. In that moment, I knew he couldn't do it. And I had to be that person where I was hugging my sister and my dad and being that pillar of support for them. Ironically, one of my last conversations that I had with my mom was a conversation that I was planning on getting a husky for my apartment in Long Island. When my mom passed, it put a little urgency in that situation, and I thought it was the perfect time to get a dog for the family, to bring something positive in a moment where all we had what seemed to be was negativity. There was 2 dogs in the store. One was obviously Roxy. One was an all black lab, which was adorable. But I saw Roxy's eyes, they're ice blue. They just were very warm and welcoming. Reminded me a lot of my mom as she had bluish eyes. And I said, this is the perfect dog. I remember I brought her home to my dad with like a little yellow bow tie on that the store put on for her. And when I brought the dog in, he was so confused, like, what is this? Whose dog is this? And when I told him I got us a dog, he just started crying. And my dad is not a guy who cries. I think I saw him cry maybe 2-3 times at max. He's like, it's too early. Your mom just passed. We're not ready for this. This isn't even a breed I like. He just started going to full child mode. Roxy was just sitting and now reacting to him crying, screaming, and just looking at him, just completely seated, like well-behaved, as if she's been trained her whole life. She was 3 months old at the time, tiny little husky. And here she is with a little bow tie looking at him. So he calls her over and she comes over and starts licking him. And from that moment on, I saw he fell in love. He looked at her eyes and he said, she looks like a Roxy to me. She's really become a true member of our family. Thank you guys for watching. Again, happy Mother's Day to all you moms out there. I like to leave you off on a quote that I wrote a couple of years ago on Mother's Day on one of my Instagram photos. I know today's Mother's Day, but I want to make a point to remind everyone that you don't have to wait to tell them how much you love them until Mother's Day. Tell them today. Tell them tomorrow. Tell them yesterday. Because in this crazy life, you never know what tomorrow may bring. Мама, никогда не забывай, я тебя очень люблю. Mom, never forget, I'll always love you so much. Hey guys, on behalf of me and Roxy, we'd like to thank you for watching my video. If you have any questions for me or Roxy, you can leave them down below in the comments section. And if you haven't yet, hit subscribe.